We're off to the races.
Congratulations.
I know, how about that? Right on time. We'll start with Luther's morning prayer. If you know it and you want to pray it aloud, please feel free. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. I thank you, my Heavenly Father, through Jesus Christ, your dear Son, that you have kept me this night from all harm and danger. Keep me this day also from sin and every evil, that all my doings in life may please you. Into your hands I commend my body and soul and all things. Let your holy angel be with me, that the wicked foe may have no power over me. Amen. Okay, so this morning we finish up our study of the Lutheran Confessions. Today we're on the Formula Concord. And if you're not awake, I would suggest that you take your dress shoes off and put your tennies on and your running shirt, because we're going to hasten here. We're going to take a look at some of the Formula Concord articles. Just to bring you up to speed, one more. That's what we've studied so far. We left off with the small called articles last week. Small called articles were, just as a point of reference for your own head, Luther was asked by his elector, by his governor, to write his own confession of what he believed. And the hope was that, unlike the Augsburg Confession, they would actually be able to have a debate or a disputation or at least a conversation with some representative of the Roman Catholic Church. And they would use Luther's confession, the small called articles, as the basis for it. That conversation, that meeting, never happened. But the small called articles were adopted as one of the confessions of the Lutheran Church. Okay, so that's in 1437. If Luther was born in 1483, he died in 1546. About 4 months after he died, Charles V, Emperor of the Holy Roman Empire, went into league with the Pope, and they decided that they were going to wage war on the German princes, especially the Lutheran German princes, and it was called the Small Called War. And that happened right after Luther passed away. From that, the Roman Catholics came to the Lutherans and they said, okay, what we're going to do is we're going to rewrite how you're doing things, all right? And it was called the Augsburg Interim. Interim because it's a temporary agreement of how we're going to have church, do church. It's Augsburg because it was written up and signed by all parties concerned in Augsburg. It was supposed to just be a temporary document until they could actually sort things around. From the Augsburg Interim, basically what it threw, the bone that they threw, the Roman Catholics threw to the Lutherans, was that they got women and they got wine out of it. That's an easy way to remember it. They were allowed to retain the wine in the Lord's Supper, so they could still have Lord's Supper in two kinds, both kinds. And any clergy that had married, they were allowed to keep their wives. Isn't that generous of the Roman Catholic Church? Yeah? So that's what came out of the Augsburg Interim. Okay, there was this guy by the name of Maurice of Saxony in between those two lines there. Maurice of Saxony kind of ended up taking over. So you remember Elector Frederick, who really loved Luther and protected him and hijacked him, you know, kidnapped him and kept him safe. And then his brother, after he died, took over. And then after he died, his son Maurice was the Elector of Saxony. Maurice could smell the winning side. So basically what he did is he turned against his Lutheran brothers and he made a pact to be in agreement with Charles V and the Pope and go over to the Roman Catholic side and bring his entire duchy, his province, along with him. And the people were absolutely outraged by this. And they turned on him and they would not cooperate with him, and he could sense it. And after some time, he came to his spiritual and political senses, and he decided that what he was going to do was he was going to attack Charles V, and he resoundingly defeated Charles V. And out of that came this Leipzig Interim. The Leipzig Interim was really started before the war by Melanchthon as a way to counteract what had been imposed upon the Lutherans. And while it seemed as though it was giving an awful lot to the Lutherans. In actuality, it really sold out a lot of the doctrines that the Lutherans had stood for. In other words, there was not a clear confession of justification by faith through grace alone. Nothing was mentioned in there at all. The Latin Mass was allowed, they conceded the Latin Mass could come back into the church rather than the Deutsche Messe, the German Mass that Luther had developed. And then also things like the Mass as a form of or rite of worship, where you were actually re-sacrificing the body and blood of Christ, was allowed back into the church. Extreme unction, which was basically last rites. What else was there? I know there was a couple other things. Vestments as prescribed by the Roman Catholic Church had to be brought back into the faith life of the priests and the people. And then festivals and fasts and feasts were allowed to be brought back in, but they were conceded as non-essential. Okay, so it's this Leipzig interim and all this mess that's going on between the two sides that finally brought the church fathers together, and they formed a committee of the best and the brightest of their theologians. And it's this committee that developed the Formula of Concord. There's Maurice in 1552. You can see how far after the Leipzig, 4 years after the Leipzig interim. And then there's the Formula of Concord that finally gets developed 40 years, or completed 40 years after the small cold articles. So, quite amount of time. So the Formula Concord then is basically addressing a host of different topics. Some of them were pressing at the time. There was heresy that was starting to encroach into the Lutheran Church, which is exactly what Luther feared. He feared that the greatest key truth of the gospel, justification by grace through faith alone, would quickly be lost. And it was definitely on a slippery slope heading towards the fiery abyss. And it is often said in his church history circles that if it had not been for the second Martin, Martin Chemnitz, the first Martin and his work would have probably been lost to history. Okay? I think that's probably a little overstated, but it's not too far from the truth. What you have is you're going to see in these different articles, and we're just going to look at snippets of them. In these articles is you have the Reformed Church, the Calvinists, the Zwingli and the Calvinists, making inroads into the theological thinking of the Lutheran Church, especially in southern Germany. And Melanchthon was one of them, okay? So let's take a look at it. That's pretty much the introduction that I've given to you. Look, what we're gonna do is we're gonna look at two of the articles first. And I'm going to give you just a little bit more that you can, a little bit more meat than what you have here. And then we'll work our way through to the actual reading of the Formula Concord and then the epitome. So I would ask for a volunteer. If you see where it says in big bold type, the controversies that developed after Luther's death, the Flacian controversy, Article 1, let's find out what that is, and then I'll add a little bit of facts for you. Someone want to read that paragraph for us? And their good outdoor soccer pitch voice.
This controversy went on from 1560 to 1575. A very important member of the true Lutheran party, Matthias Flacius, in his desire to uphold the truth about mankind's natural inability to do anything good, went too far. He said that our sinful flesh was sin itself. Flacius' motives were good, but his way of speaking went beyond scripture.
Okay, so Matthias Flacius was actually a very solid confessional Lutheran. He had studied under Luther. Luther admired him. Luther appreciated him. But Flacius actually overstated the issue about the inherent original sin within the human being. Now, let's just take a look at it. It's probably just a little bit more than you probably want or need this morning, but I think it's important that you understand, because the Flacian controversy is a key classic example of when you want to make a seemingly definitive doctrinal statement, you don't stop to think through what the ramifications are down the road of what I've just said, okay? You throw out this statement and you don't realize what heresy is actually going to bubble up. There are two terms, there are a lot of philosophical terms that theologians have borrowed for centuries and centuries and centuries. And it's always in Latin, and it's substantia, and it is occidentia. And I'm sure that the Latin speakers are cringing at how I pronounce that right now, but that's how we say it at the seminary, so that'll work. Basically, what you have is, think of your body, okay? Substantially, the substance, the very essence of the human being begins with the body as it was created by God in the Garden of Eden, okay? That body can be changed accidentally or have a different attribute given to it, added to the substance of the body. Like, we can change the color of the skin, but that doesn't change the essence that you are a human being, correct? You can have an accident and have a leg or an arm removed. That changes you on the outside, but it doesn't essentially change the substance or the essence of your human body, correct? That's the idea between substantia and occidentia. And you need to keep those two in mind, because what we're going to end up learning here, is that original sin is occidentia. Because, I'm getting ahead of myself. Let's go to the next slide. If after the fall, original sin is the very substance or essence of man, what would that mean? In other words, what was Flacius saying? Flacius would have been saying that it makes Jesus sinful and less than pure and divine, because he took on human flesh. All right? He received human flesh from his mother and conceived by the Holy Spirit. If the human body was made evil and made sinful at its very substance and core, that would make Jesus less than divine. Do you see the ramifications of that? We would still be in our sin. Okay? Also, what it does is it would mean that God made us sinful and he's responsible for our fall. And then some of the theologians went so far as to say, and what it would do is it would make Satan responsible, or the creator of evil in man. Is Satan responsible for the evil in man? Is he a contributing player? Yes, we. Mm-hmm. Is he responsible for the evil in man?
No.
Don't get yourself off the hook here. Because we tend to want to throw stones and blame Satan for the fall into sin. No, man is responsible for his own evil. Right? Okay, so that's what that would essentially be saying, and why Fallacious was countered on this. Two truths which must find acceptance in this, and this is what they wrestled with in this controversy. If original sin were our substance or our essence, we could not confess God as our creator, because we would have an evil God. And yet the scriptures say there is no evil within him. Right? So they had to wrestle with that. Also, man's nature is the work of God. That we can agree on, and that's precisely what the theologians at the time agreed on. But then they went the next logical step. If man's nature is the work of God, that's correct, sin is the work then of the devil. Ah, but there's the problem. Sin is not the work of the devil. Because if sin is the work of the devil, then that puts him on the same power, strength, and category as God. And what you've just done is you turned your Christian faith into Zoroastrianism or Taoism, and you now have a theology of dualism. You have a God of good and you have a God of bad. And yet we know what about Satan? He's a created angel who rebelled, right? So these are the things that you need to think about before you decide you're going to open your mouth as a theologian. What are the ramifications of what I'm saying? Flacius meant well. He really did. But he obviously went way too far on this whole thing. One last slide, I think, here before we get to Article 2. Scripture and Luther both stress the total depravity of man. They're not arguing that. They speak of sin as intruding upon man's essential nature. The epitome that we're going to look at a little bit later, but it addresses this particular article. Sin so pervades humanity that we could not tell the difference between the nature and the corruption if God's word had not pointed it out. And that hints very strongly, that's a big hint, when you have these controversies, where do you go to determine what is the definitive truth that God has revealed to us? the word. It's the only clear signal, the only clear beacon, the only clear message that clears up the muddiness and makes things light again. Right? So, questions on that article? I know, I told you to put your tinnies on. I hope you brought coffee this morning. I didn't bring enough for myself. On to the second article. Can I get a volunteer to read that synergistic controversy, Article 2?
Philip Melanchthon was Luther's right-hand man. He played a major role in the Reformation. He organized Scripture's teachings so they could be more easily understood and taught. However, from what he wrote in the 1550 edition of his doctrine book, it became clear that he had departed from Scripture's teaching. He claimed that three causes work together to bring a person to faith: the Holy Spirit, the voice of the gospel, and the will of man, which does not resist the divine voice, but somehow will with trepidation assents. God therefore begins and draws by the voice of the gospel, but he draws him who is willing and assists him to assent. After Luther's death, other teachers in the Lutheran Church accepted Melanchthon's teachings. He helped spread them. The church had to wrestle with this issue. The question is whether or not, before conversion, we in any way are able to come to faith in the gospel by an act or of our free will. This controversy, settled by Article 2, went on from 1555 to 1560.
Yeah. It probably did not need to go on that long, for 5 years, if Melanchthon had been better at knowing his Bible than knowing his church fathers and philosophizing. Because there's a very simple passage that you can jot down on your notes. 1 Corinthians 12:3. No one can say that Jesus Christ is Lord, can you finish it? Except by the Holy Spirit. That would have handled this whole controversy. Synergism is the belief that you see in most evangelical big box churches these days. Baptists buy into it. It's this idea that I and another power together are going to co-op our strengths and we're going to make a conversion of an individual. So you can have varying levels. You can say that God is 99% of the power and man is only 1%, but he still has to agree to what God is proposing to him, that you are a sinner and that I choose to have faith in Jesus Christ. Okay? Outwardly, it may appear that somewhere along the line, especially in the adult confirmand, they made the decision that what they were learning in BIC class made sense and they believed that Jesus really was their savior from sin. But the truth of the matter is the scripture describes the whole process a totally different way. You have a heart that is dead and cold in sin. Dead means dead. And human beings cannot bring dead things back to life. Okay? Even with the paddles. Okay? If you are dead, then the only way that you can be brought to faith is by the power of the Holy Spirit going into that dead heart and soul and giving it life and rejuvenating it and resurrecting it and bringing it back in order to now walk in life with its Savior. Okay? I mean, just think of Ephesians 2 passage. It is by grace you have been saved through faith. This not of yourselves. It is a gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. Making a decision to believe in Jesus is a work. We don't have the spiritual power within us. There's also a classic phrase that says, when it comes to free will, man has no spiritual free will. None whatsoever. Because dead means dead. Let's take a look at it. Melanchthon fell for it.
I was going to say, it's reflected very well in the explanation of the second article of the Creed.
It is explained very well there. Yeah. Let's take a look at it. There are some Latin phrases which the Latin readers will love. And this is maybe cap class material and maybe not Sunday morning Bible class material. But I'm going to go through it real quickly because this came into the discussion. All right? And it was also, I also use this for cap class. And there's basically three phrases, and about the mid-1800s, that third one was kind of added just to kind of help with the leap. Able not to sin is before the fall. There's only two human beings in the history of mankind that ever qualified for able not to sin. Now that would be Adam and Eve. Yeah, who had the full image of God, the full holiness and righteousness of God. All right. Then there is this not able not to sin. And that would be human beings after the fall, before conversion. Okay? And that would be also the good angels who were convicted in their goodness and the evil angels that were convicted in their evilness. All right? Then in the mid-1800s, maybe late 1700s, this third point was kind of added. New man is able to cooperate with God after conversion. And don't let that go to your theological head and say, wait a minute, I just thought you told us that we can't cooperate with God. After conversion, in your life of sanctification, when the Holy Spirit, which is known in theological terms as the mystic union, the Holy Spirit takes up residence inside your heart, and it prompts the new man to want to do good works. We're going to get to good works, too, in the majoristic controversy. Okay? And that new man then is walking parallel or in cooperation with the triune God and the Holy Spirit that's living inside of you. Is the triune God doing 99.999% of the heavy lifting? Absolutely. Don't give yourself too much theological credit here. Okay? But the new man is cooperating with the Holy Spirit in that it wants to study God's word. It wants to know what God's will is for their life. It wants to know how to be a better husband in a marriage. It wants to know how to be a better wife. It wants to know how to be a better son, a civic, in their civic righteousness, in their duties as a citizen. Okay? How to take care of Aunt Nellie. What do I do with the poor? Okay? And that third point that came into this whole discussion of synergism is not able to sin is going to be you and me when we finally get to heaven. But for now, there's a struggle. There's a battle. Okay? So that came into the conversation. Article 3. Any questions on synergism? Jen?
Sorry, I have a question. So I 100% agree with the fact that our faith is 100% God's work. I understand that.
Yeah.
We can turn it over. No issues with that. But I get a little bit confused when I think about certain groups of people that do not have faith. One, because I think my first question is it, does God sometimes choose not to give people faith?
Ooh.
And then my second question is, if God gives faith to everyone, how does that work with people who are given faith would even consider rejecting it? Like, I get a bit confused when you look at the non-believers. Like, in theory, I understand
right. That
faith is given to us, but then I don't really understand why some people don't have it.
Yeah, the Calvinists, who are very reasonable and rational people, and allow their reason and logic to overrule what the scriptures say, essentially came up with a doctrine called double predestination. Why are some saved and others are damned? Okay? And it's two questions packed into one that you really have to explode and break apart into two separate questions. Why are some people saved? The answer is...
Because they believe in Jesus as their Savior.
Well, let's put it more in.
Yes. We're all saved, right? Unless we reject.
Let's not get to the reject part yet. That's part of the second half.
Right.
Yeah.
We're saved through our faith.
If a person is saved, it's because of the grace of God.
Yes.
Okay. If a person is damned, the answer is.
It's their own fault.
It's their own fault because the Holy Spirit has come to them and revealed to them that they are by nature sinful and an object of God's wrath. But the good news is that God has taken care of that in his Son Jesus, who is your righteousness. And your old sinful nature now either receives the gift that God has given to you or rejects that gift that God has given to you. Yeah? So that kind of answers the first part of your question. God wants all people to be saved and come to a knowledge of the truth. So he has not pre-chosen this side of the room to be true Christians, and the rest of this room are a bunch of hypocrites who just say that they believe in Jesus Christ. We go upon a person's confession. But he wants all people to be saved.
But when you say that we either receive or reject, the wording makes me feel like there is some part that we're actively receiving.
Yeah, I know it does.
Okay. I just have a hard time.
Yeah, but like receiving, receiving is described as the receiving hand. I just, my hand, that's even too active.
Yeah.
But my hand is sitting there, and God comes and puts the gift of faith right into my hand. I'm not grasping for it. I'm not going for it because I don't have any spiritual power to do that. And when you say reject, think exactly about when your son rejects the stewed turnips that you've made for him. That's an active decision on his part.
Yes.
Right? Okay. But think in theological terms. The Holy Spirit is coming to your old Adam, your old sinful nature. What does the sinful nature do naturally? It's hostile. So when we say that that sinful nature in a human being rejects the gift of the gospel, that's not an active kind of action on their part. They're just being what they naturally are since the fall. Yeah. They're just being what they are. They're being a scumpy, dirty, sinful, wretched enemy of God. They're just and they're saying, I have no interest in your gospel. I don't need it. I don't want it. Go away. Now, what was the second question that she had?
I don't remember now, but I just feel like I don't understand why some people, I guess, successfully, like in a bad way, but I mean, they totally reject, but I feel like I'm going back into this
fear. No, because we...
They don't have faith because somehow, even though
Right. Oh, absolutely.
Salvation. I don't understand how it's possible for some people to not
hear the message and then reject it.
Yeah, like I don't understand why some people do.
To describe as best as we can the actions of the sinful nature, the church has developed a term called the opinio legis. In highfalutin Latin, what that means is my opinion of the law. And my opinion of the law as an old Adam, as a sinful wretch, says, I don't need your grace. In fact, I don't want your grace. In fact, if I'm going to make myself right with you, I'm going to make myself right with you. I'm going to try to keep your laws. I'm going to try to do something to make you smile or smirk or make you happy. And obviously the law has not been preached in its full fury to that individual because they don't realize the consequences that a dead individual, a dead soul, can do absolutely bumpkiss to impress a holy and gracious God. Zip. I mean, that's one of the reasons why. And we have that opinio legis still in ourselves. Don't fool yourself.
Yeah, this baffles me how somebody knows the truth and has been coming to church for 20 years and then suddenly disappears off the radar.
Yeah.
Just for no apparent reason.
Yeah. Well, it probably could be because of lack of the use of means of grace.
Yeah.
Which is one reason why your pastors exhort you to be in the Word or to exercise the means of grace in your life on a regular basis. But yeah, it's absolutely baffling.
I feel like everyone else gets it. I'm
No, say what? What?
Oh, I feel like everyone else gets it.
Well, you probably, no, I'm not sure everybody else does get it. They're just maybe not bold enough to actually raise the question. That's what's wonderful about having a collection of adults.
And it's not that I'm questioning it.
No, I'm not taking it that way.
Fully understand.
It is sad.
Yeah.
It is sad. So if you have a family member, and usually what happens, and I'm not, if you have a family member, usually what will happen is they're educated and they've gravitated not to, I don't need grace, I do need orderly logic science. That answers my world to me, okay? Then what you do is you have a loving, gentle, if that makes sense, furious discussion about the thoroughgoing nature of sin, and it's a harsh, bold preaching of the law. To say, you know what, you think you got it all figured out. What if you're wrong? If you're wrong, what I've just told you about your nature before God, you're doomed. So what's it going to hurt you? And if I'm wrong, in the end, how has it made my life a worse thing? Nothing. It's made me a more patient mom, generally speaking. It's made me a more compassionate wife. It's made me a more active, civically righteous citizen, or mother helping the teacher at school. I mean, actually, all the influences of the Christian faith, mom, dad, brother, sister, have actually outwardly, seemingly, everyone would agree, made my life richer and more positive in society, in my family, and in my church life. So, but if I'm wrong, and I die, and I become worm food, and there is no afterlife, and there's no Savior, and there's no God, what have I left behind? I've left behind a legacy of goodness, right? Moral uprightness. But if you're wrong, your decision has eternal consequences. How can the Christian faith possibly be a bad influence on your life? That's just something for them to think about. Yeah? So, good question. Did I sort of answer it?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, before we get to Article 3, what we're going to do is we're going to have a rousing reading of a sample from the Thoreau Declaration, just so that you can get a feel for what this thing says. And then we'll get on to the other articles that we have lined up for us. So can I get, can I get a volunteer to maybe read half of that, and then I'll take the lat, or I get another volunteer to pick up the one party held. Someone want to read that for us, the first two paragraphs? Please.
Because the conflict developed not only between the Papists and our theologians, but also among some theologians of the Augsburg Confession on the topic of the free will, we want to indicate first of all what this controversy was about. Because the human being with its free will can be found and analyzed in four distinct but similar conditions, the present question is not how the will functioned as originally created before the fall, or what powers it exercises in internal matters concerning temporal life before its conversion, or what kind of free will human beings will have in spiritual matters after they have been reborn and are being ruled by God's Spirit, or what kind of free will they will have when they arise from the dead. Instead, the chief question is, purely and simply, what the mind and will of the unregenerated human being are able to do in conversion and rebirth on the basis of their own powers that remain after the fall, when God's word is proclaimed and God's grace is offered to us. Can people prepare themselves for this grace and accept it, giving a yes to it? This is the question concerning which some theologians argued for many years in the churches of the Augsburg Confession.
Okay, someone want to pick up those next three paragraphs, or you want me to read it?
The one party held and taught that although human beings cannot fulfill God's command on the basis of their own powers, and cannot truly trust, fear, and love God without the grace of the Holy Spirit, they certainly retain enough natural powers before rebirth so that they can in some way prepare themselves to receive grace, even though weakly, and to give their yes. However, without the addition of the grace of the Holy Spirit, they could accomplish nothing with these powers, but would have to suffer defeat in the battle. Moreover, the ancient and modern
ravers,
or enthusiasts, taught this, that God converts human beings without created means and tools, that is, through the Spirit, apart from the external proclamation and hearing of God's word, and that he draws them apart from these means to saving knowledge of Christ. Against these two parties, the pure teachers of the Augsburg Confession have taught and contended that human beings were so corrupted through the fall of our first parents that in spiritual matters concerning our conversion and the salvation of our soul, they are by nature blind, and that when God's word is preached, they do not and cannot understand it. Instead, they regard it as foolishness and cannot use it to bring themselves nearer to God. On the contrary, they are and remain God's enemy until by grace alone, without any contribution of their own, they are converted, made believers, reborn, and renewed by the power of the Holy Spirit through the word as it is preached and heard.
Thank you very much to our readers. Three paragraphs up from the bottom is one party, and that's really the Melanchthonian and the Philippist party, who really said, albeit there be a little bit, or ever so small, there are things that human beings can do that will actually bring about a yes to the Holy Spirit's plea of the gospel, okay, the Holy Spirit's gift of the gospel, all right? And on the very major side, there was pure unadulterated decision theology. Within the same party, at the very minimum, there were those who would say, well, if, for example, a husband is married to a Christian wife, and she has prayers, and she reads her Bible out loud, that man is brought into an environment where he's exposed to the means of grace, and that's kind of getting him set up for the yes, okay? Still dangerous talk, all right? Because it's still brought in, they're making the decision. On the other hand, the other party, in the second paragraph up from the bottom, was basically going so far as not just only synergism, but these were the Karlstadt guys, who also had been a stalwart ally of Luther in the early days, and when Luther was squirreled away at Wartburg in the castle for his own safety, Karlstadt is the one who basically started throwing the baby out with the bathwater. The statues, the icons, any sort of crosses, and got the people riled up. He went so far as to become what Luther called a flaming Schwärmer. Buzzing bees is basically the translation of Schwärmer. He believed that a person could come to faith apart from the means of grace, apart from the place where the Holy Spirit has promised to work. That is the Bible and his sacraments, okay? Karlstadt believed that the Holy Spirit could come to a person immediately or directly apart from the words of the Bible. Can the Holy Spirit do that? I hope your answer is, the Holy Spirit is God. He can do anything he wants to. But for sinful man, where does sinful man look to know for certain where God is going to promise to come to me? God's Word. And that's where Karlstadt went off the rails. Luther had no problem with Karlstadt believing that the Holy Spirit could, if he wanted to, come immediately to a person. In fact, that's the way he worked with all the prophets. Right? But he never promised anywhere in his Bible, in the year 483 BC, I'm going to come to Isaiah. Right? He did it where and when it suited him. Okay? But he has promised to come to us in his word. So it's that third bottom paragraph, or the sixth paragraph, the bottom paragraph, that's basically laying out the stand of the confessional Lutherans. So basically saying, we have no power within us to make a decision for anything other than what we already are, and that is evil and sin and hostility and alienation from God. Okay? So there's a little sampling of the reading from the Formula of Concord on the synergistic controversy. Questions? Brian.
So when someone says to you, I realized, or I gave up my faith, or I gave into my faith on a certain date at a certain time, is that realistic or not?
Oh, well, you know, they're remembering a date and a time that they had a mental conscious note of when all of a sudden they believe that Jesus is their Savior.
Right.
I think you've heard the story many a time from me, but now's an appropriate time to replace it, that Karen's parents and her aunt, in their retirement years, pooled their money, and they started a Christian bookstore in Greendale, Wisconsin. And it was huge. It was one of the most successful Christian bookstores in the metro Milwaukee area. And obviously, Hillary, being a well-trained, he was a good verger. He was really a frustrated, he should have probably become a pastor, is what he should have been. You know, he's one of those kind of guys. Kind of like a lot of the men that we have in this church and in this room right now, and think of like Karl Nofke, okay? Just knows his Bible inside and out. As an adult, continues to love to read the confessions, to read pastoral theology textbooks, okay? That's who my father-in-law was like, all right? Well-versed. And he would have people come in the store all the time and tell him, you know, when did you become a Christian? When did you become a Christian? And they would say, well, it was the 17th of July, 1978, and I think it was somewhere after lunch, but it was before the afternoon beer, you know, or whatever. And that was a typical response. And then they'd look at him very excitedly and say, when did you believe in Jesus? When were you brought to faith? And he would just look at them and he'd say, when I was a day and a half old in the waters of baptism. And then one of two things would happen from there. they would start arguing with him, that he's not like he's some kind of second-class Christian, because you haven't consciously made a decision for Jesus. Or it would just be like, and that's when, depending on the barometric temperature of the room, the person, he could talk to them about, this is where God has promised that he's going to come to us, in his means of grace, his gospel in word and sacrament. You know, and that's what the Bible says. Well, that sounds awfully Lutheran. Well, because that's because Lutherans believe what the Bible says. So I just look at it and I go, that's great. That's wonderful. I praise God that you believe in Jesus as your Savior, and you see where the conversation goes from there.
I heard it so often over the years that at some point I wondered why it wasn't happening to me. You know, I never had that all of a sudden moment. You know, just, I never remembered it anyway. It just happened.
No, because it happened in the waters of baptism, and our memories don't, we don't have the cognitive ability to remember that when we're infants. So.
It took me a long time to realize the importance of that action by my parents to bring me as a child and have me baptized.
Huge.
Huge, but it took me probably 50 years to realize that.
Well, you know, it's always better late than never.
True.
You know?
Thank you, man.
Yeah, it's always better late than never. Okay, any other questions on the reading from the Formula Concord, the thorough declaration? Otherwise, I'm going to get you into some of the other articles before we run out of time here. Because today has to be it, because then Pastor Thompson's going to start next Sunday on a study of 1 John, which looks really good. All right, so I've kind of already answered those two questions for you. So I'm going to get into Article 3. And this is called the Osiandrian Controversy and the Stancarian Controversy, but they're essentially the same. Could I get a volunteer to read that description of Article 3 so we can just kind of have a little taste? And then I'll elaborate a little bit for you.
After Luther's death, some theologians in the Lutheran Church tried to change the reason why we can't be sure of eternal life. Led by a man named Osiander, they told people to look at what God is doing within them, rather than what God did for them in Christ. It is not hard to see why Osiander erred in saying this. It is the way the Catholic Church has been teaching for centuries.
Yeah, so let's take a look at it. Osiander opposed the Reformation's emphasis on the forensic sense of justification. Forensic and imputed are synonyms. Forensic is a term that is borrowed from legal or courtroom terminology. So it's a legal declaration by the judge or by the jury. You are guilty or you are not guilty. Okay? So he opposed this forensic justification of this declaration of you are declared innocent. The truth of the matter is, just as a little aside, the Greek word dikaios, which means righteousness, okay, we often think of as God has declared you not guilty. In truth, I know, I'm kind of shaving it very, but just so you understand the color of the word. You're not being declared not guilty. The dikaios also means to be acquitted. So the truth of the matter is that in Christ, God is saying you are acquitted. You do not have to pay the penalty for your sin. You're guilty of sin, but I'm letting you free. Puts a totally different color on it, doesn't it? Okay, so he denied that. Imputed righteousness is something that you do not have in yourself, and it is gifted to you. It is put inside of you. Okay, so imputed forensic righteousness, basically synonyms, just two different ways of saying the same thing. He said, that we're not saying, the Bible doesn't say, Osiander and Stancarius said, justification is not an act which God declares sinners righteous. It's an act by which God makes him man righteous by dwelling in him. Also, he's not saved by imputed righteousness. Man was righteous because of the indwelling of the divine nature, just saying the same thing a different way. It's a progressive righteousness that saved sinners. Justification became process, and that's where he has the parallel with the Roman Catholic Church. What's wrong with this theology? Well, the simple and straightforward answer is it's not what the Bible teaches. Do you remember years back, probably it's popular 20 years ago and you still see them, the little rubber bracelets that say WWJD? What would Jesus do? And there was a lot of pushback, especially in the Midwest, by our clergy, that they didn't really like to see those on their kids' wrists. And the parents were like, man, what's wrong with you? They're wearing a Jesus bracelet. This is cool. I haven't been able to get my teen to church for years, but all of a sudden now they're wearing a what would Jesus do in this particular situation to get my son or my daughter to stop and think, what would Jesus do in this situation? And they weren't opposed to that, but they were good confessional Lutherans, and they really wanted to get the message out, what has Jesus done? See, there's the difference. What would Jesus do is looking inside myself. What has Jesus done is what the scriptures teach. Yeah? The truth of the matter is that the Holy Spirit, the mystic union, does come and dwell inside of you. But when you're looking for answers to theological questions, do you want to be what Professor Deutschlander calls a navel gazer? What good answers did you ever get from yourself, spiritually?
None.
But when you look outside of yourself, because that's just natural man. Natural religion always looks inside of himself and creates a God from that. Christianity is the religion that says, get your head up off of your belly button, stop being a navel gazer, and look outside yourself and see what God has already done for you. Yeah? So that's where he erred. That's Osiander. And Stancarius was just a little bit later, and he basically followed the same teaching. Osiander opposed the Reformation's emphasis. Here's two other points that he said. Human nature of Christ is only a connection through which the divine nature, with its righteousness, wisdom, and power, is channeled to the believer. In other words, it confuses the dual nature of Christ. He totally messed up this understanding of you have 100% God and 100% man, and the communication of attributes of how those two communicate with one another. And finally, it promotes an incarnational theology. An incarnational theology is basically that Jesus would have come to earth anyway, even if Adam and Eve had not fallen into sin. It's total speculation. If Adam and Eve had not fallen into sin, why would Jesus, the second person in the Trinity, had to have come to earth? We have no evidence of that because they were already 100% in holiness and righteousness in the image of God already, right? So this is just, anyway. Questions on the Osiandrian controversy? Okay, on to Article 4. Let's see what we can learn from that. Someone want to read Article 4, the majoristic controversy? The little blurb.
The church after Luther, and even when he was still alive, struggled to express the relation between faith and works. Sadly, many theologians came up with expressions that did not reflect scripture. Some said, good works are necessary for salvation. The wrong way of speaking is dealt with in this article. The scriptural way of speaking is this, good works are necessary.
Period. Let's take a look at it. You've got three guys on your screen. Melanchthon was concerned about cheap grace. A person's profession of faith should match their Christian life. Melanchthon was motivated by a lot of good things. It's just that his outcome was always not the best theologically. He basically was concerned about, does the Christian walk match the talk? Okay? That's a good concern to have. That's a good pastoral concern to have. Melanchthon then went on to say good works were essential to salvation, a contributing factor or cause. Oops. Wow. Then Kreuziger, which was a buddy of his, good works are indeed not the essential cause of salvation, but nevertheless an indispensable cause. He kind of backs away from Melanchthon a little bit, but he's still in the same camp, that my works somehow contribute to my salvation. And then you have Major, which is what this article is named after. Good works do not merit salvation, but are necessary to maintain salvation. Well, now remember, you're going to see this quote from Luther, and you're going to go, well, okay, that's cool that Luther sounded in on this, except Luther's dead right now. So remember, they're getting this from his writings and from the small called articles. And Luther said, good works are detrimental to the righteousness of faith. if one presumes to be justified by them. Wow, that clears things up. Good works follow after faith. Good works do not create faith. That's where most of evangelical Protestantism in America is right now. Sanctification comes first to prove your justification. The bad problem with that is, what if you don't feel so sanctified when you wake up in the morning? And then the devil perches on your shoulder and whispers into your ear, are you really a Christian and are you really going to heaven? The beauty about it is by grace you have been saved through faith, this not of yourselves. It's this idea that when you are at your lowest low, you can be guaranteed with certainty that God's Son lived and died and rose again for you, no matter how you feel about it. You can't change that fact. That Christmas happened in history for you. Even if I'm medically depressed, even if I'm clinically bummed out, right? That truth still stands. Most of Christendom today is not teaching what the Bible teaches, sadly. And so then you go on a spiritual roller coaster. How is that any more comforting than the Roman Catholic Church teaching purgatory that I can't guarantee you that your Uncle Fester is in heaven right now because he believed in Jesus? Oh, no, no, no. He's got to go through a little purification process first. That's awful. Awful theology. Let's take a look at Article 5 and 6. We'll see how far we can get here. Article 5 and 6, the antinomian controversy. Antinomian, nomos is the Greek word for law, and anti is against or in place of or instead of. This controversy also began already during the life of Luther. There were a small number of pastors and university teachers who taught that it was no longer necessary to teach Christians the law. They taught that since Christians are reborn and regenerated, they now have the will of God written on their hearts and no longer need to hear it with their ears. They believed the good news of the gospel would teach them all they need to know. This teaching also led them to discard the third use of the law as God. The chief proponent of this false teaching was John Agricola. The Formula Concord deals with this controversy in two articles. So the two articles that you have is Article 5 is basically concerning the law and the gospel. And I've got a couple quotes from Luther in there for you. Since the fall, the law has the purpose of revealing sin. Luther also said the second one, the law differs from the gospel as a demand laid upon us differs from a gift given to us. And what really benefited these theologians on this committee who were on the Formula of Concord committee, I think you know enough about Luther that he spent an awful lot of time studying the scriptures, and especially the epistles, and particularly Galatians, which he ended up teaching. Okay, he gathered from the scriptures a very keen sense of the difference between law and gospel. And these insights served these guys very well and have built them up spiritually as well. So a lot of this is really kind of been plowed. This topic has been plowed already by Luther. And it was just kind of laying fallow there, waiting to be plucked out until some controversy came along and it needed to help clear the things up. Article 6 was basically concerning the third use of the law. The law still informs me of God's holy will, which is always in effect for man. And that has basically two sides. Where does the Christian, the new man, go to know what God's will is for their life? Mirror, curb, and? The law as mirror, curb, and?
Guide.
So where does the Christian go, the new man go? To the Word, to find out what is God's will for me. So there's still a use of the law. The other side, the flip side of this use of the law in a Christian's life is it forgets that you have not been made perfect, but you have not had the image of God fully restored, all holiness and righteousness, while you live on this side of the planet, because you saw that before. Not able to sin doesn't happen until we get to heaven. You still have an old sinful nature, don't you? Okay. Does that old sinful nature still need the mirror and the curb of the law?
I hope you're going. I'll speak for myself only, I guess, but I was taught to fear the law and not to embrace it and love it. You know, when I was young, like you mentioned God's law, it would shake me up for days, you know.
Good.
But I was just too young to realize it, or just too uninformed.
Maybe both.
Yeah, it took me a long time to see the love in the law.
Yeah.
You know, and that's something I've only learned probably in the last 10 years.
Yeah, and you know, the interesting, if any of you are going to pursue this, just make a mental note that when we say Torah, translated as law, you really have to be careful to understand how the Hebrew writer was using the word Torah. You can be law as in God's do's and don'ts, narrowly, or it can be the law, Torah, as in the full counsel of God. Which it also is there gospel in the Old Testament? Yeah. Please say yes. The Old Testament is not all law and no gospel. And the New Testament is not all gospel and no law. Okay, so when a Jew referred to the Torah, they were referring to the entire counsel of God, which would be the do's and don'ts, which is what we think narrow sense law, but also the gospel, okay? If you ever read any Melanchthon, he can confuse you to no end. Because Melanchthon uses the word gospel the same way the Jews use the word Torah in the wider sense. When Melanchthon uses the word gospel, he's not only talking about the good news of Jesus Christ being your Savior, he's also talking about the full counsel of God, including his law. And Christians, theologians don't normally talk that way. Normally they make that distinction since the time of the New Testament between law, narrow sense, and gospel. So if you ever read any Melanchthon, which you might do, you might be prompted to want to read some of his stuff in the context of church history, just make that mental note. Note to self. So yes, the new man, the new man does not need the law, but the human being, the Christian, still needs the law. We have time for one more? I think we do. Article 7 and 8 is basically talking about the crypto-Calvinist controversy. From a political standpoint, it would have been very advantageous for Lutheran and Reformed churches to merge and make a common stand against the Catholics. At a meeting between the Lutherans and Reformed at Marburg in 1529, Luther was there, he was alive, it became clear to Luther that such a union was impossible. Although the churches agreed on many points, they did not agree on the Lord's Supper. In the following years, Melanchthon began to waver regarding the Lutheran and scriptural understanding of the Lord's Supper. After Luther's death, Reformed teachings about the Lord's Supper wormed their way into many Lutheran schools and churches. The writers of the Formula Concord added Articles 7 and 8 to rid the Lutheran Church of these errors. So just a couple of slides just to kind of wrap us up here, and then I'll have to entrust the rest to you. Crypto really just means hidden, okay? So hidden in the sense of purposeful misrepresentation, and we're not throwing stones here. The definitely crypto-Calvinists, they looked like Lutherans, they smelled and sounded like Lutherans, but inside they were Calvinists, okay? They definitely had an agenda. We know that historically. They acted like Lutherans, they spoke using Lutheran terminology, they expressed enthusiasm for Lutherans, and their goal was to swallow Lutheranism and to bring it into Calvinism. That was ultimately their goal. They were just going to absorb Lutheranism, and they have been successful in today's Lutheran church, if you want to call it that, the state church, in Germany, in Sweden, in Norway, in Finland, in Switzerland. Yeah. Those state churches are essentially not Lutheran, but if you go as a Lutheran, you're going to hear things that make it sound like you're getting the real presence. Concerning the Lord's Supper, minute and 10 seconds, roots of Calvinistic views lie in their theology of predestination. If God from eternity decreed to save only a chosen number, then the sacrament can in no way be a seal of salvation and assurance of grace to all people through faith. God would be lying to people if he assured each individual that the body and blood was shed for them, since only a chosen few were ransomed and saved. You understand what they're saying there? Their rationale for the Lord's Supper not having the real presence was the fact that they believed in double predestination. They believed that God chose some to be saved and some to be damned, right? So there can't be the real presence, because when that Lord's Supper is given to the person who thinks they're a Christian, but they really are not, God has really predestined them to be damned, God would be lying to assure them that their sins have been forgiven, right, in the Lord's Supper. So the real presence cannot be there. That was one of their logic arguments in the Lord's Supper. So I know I've got to let you go. I have 15 seconds. They also messed up the person concerning the person of Christ, the personal union of Christ's divine and human natures. Calvin basically insisted that the union was only a matter of words. Luther insisted, what does it say in the scriptures, Calvin? And he insisted that it was reality. That was one of the propensities of Calvin, and to a degree Zwingli, and then I'll let you go. When they kind of got boxed into a corner by Luther's command of scripture, and he pointed out to them from scripture, what does the Bible say? What does God's word say? If they had, it was a topic that they hadn't thought through, rather than say, listen, give me some time to think about this, they would just kind of blow it off and say, well, it's just a matter of words. So, anyway. Questions? Whirlwind, I know. Your tennies hot from the friction, from running so hard?
Does that mean they don't look at communion as a sacrament?
They do not see it as a means of grace. No, they do not. Two church bodies really believe that there's a real presence of body and blood in with and under the bread and the wine. Lutherans and Roman Catholics. Yeah. Yeah. Well, I guess you could add Greek Orthodox or Eastern Orthodox to that. Yeah. All right. I have to let you go and get ready for worship. Thank you for letting me take you through the confessions. I would encourage you to read through this on your own. If you have questions, call me or email me. See you upstairs for worship in a few minutes.